People often assume that our senses allow us to perceive the world as it actually is. However, what we perceive is not an accurate reflection of a real, externally existing world. In fact, perception and hallucination have a lot in common. Both depend on our brain's interpretation of noisy and ambiguous sensory signals. You could say that we're all hallucinating all the time, and when we agree about our hallucinations, that's what we call reality. Most of the time, we don't question the reality of our perceptions, since most of the time, they seem real enough, and we all seem to perceive the same things. But sometimes this consensus breaks down dramatically, begging the question, what is real? Take the notorious dress from a few years ago. People violently disagreed about what color the dress really was, blue and black, or white and gold. Perceptual phenomena like this are vivid reminders of how much neurological guesswork happens behind the scenes to piece together our perceptions of the world. These perceptions are based partially on information we've learned over hundreds of thousands of years. A good example of this is the assumption that light generally comes from above. Few of us are aware of having this assumption, and yet it shapes how we see the world. If you look at an image of footprints in the sand, we perceive there to be an indentation. The darker parts are shadows made by light shining from above. But if I show you this image, the footprints suddenly look embossed. The foot appears to be raised out of the ground. These perceptual conclusions are based on implicit assumptions about where light comes from. The prior predictions, or implicit beliefs held by the brain, are essential for any kind of perception at all. They are what turn the raw material of sensory data into our projected perceptual realities. There's an old art history concept called the beholder's share. This is the idea that humans respond well to art that forces them to be involved in making sense of the image, whether we're aware of it or not. Take, for example, Impressionism. Here, the artists are reverse engineering perception. They're trying to paint light, the raw materials for perceptual interpretation. They're not trying to represent the output or the result. Your visual system has to do a little bit of work to perceive, to understand the image. And so, in essence, you are participating in the creation of the work. In neuroscience, we're beginning to understand a little bit of how this happens in our brains. When we look at an image like this, we at first just see some black and white splodges. But then, if we look at this image, we can clearly see a woman and a horse. Now, if we look at the first image again, we can still see the horse and the woman. What's remarkable here is that the sensory input, the raw material, hasn't changed at all. All that's changed is your brain's prior expectations, and that changes what you consciously see. It's almost as if we can't perceive something unless we can imagine it. Unless we can imagine it, we cannot perceive it. One way we can learn about how the brain implements predictive perception is by putting people in brain scanners. Several studies now suggest that sensory signals come from the outside in, while perceptual predictions flow from the inside out. Imagine looking at some fluffy clouds that resolve into a familiar face. The brain's predictive machinery is engaged so that what starts as ambiguous becomes clear. What we experience as engagement, perhaps as aesthetic pleasure, or being carried along by a narrative, may relate to this process when prior beliefs and sensory evidence dance with each other in just the right way. All our perceptions are a kind of storytelling by the brain. And so, by shaping this process, storytelling itself has the power to change our perceptions. So we learn to experience the world in new ways. As the beholder's share emphasizes, if you look at a piece of conceptual art and have no context for viewing it, you won't be able to perceive it in the way the artist made space for, because you're not equipped to imagine the experiences that it's supposed to evoke. The art of storytelling here lies in finding the fringes, finding the edges of what people can imagine. You go too far, and your audience's prior beliefs can't handle the data you're giving them. Don't go far enough, and the experience is trivial. Perhaps great storytellers inherently know that a successful narrative doesn't work unless you engage the person, compelling them to be part of the process of making and remaking their perceptual worlds.